Welcome to Windows to the World. This morning with Dr. Alison Mann, I would like to introduce you all to our speaker. I'll give you a little bit of background. We just got through doing a really interesting intercultural simulation, diplomacy situation with simulation with two classes, and it was very exciting. It was really went well. It was great. So Dr. Alison Mann is the public historian at the U.S. Diplomacy Center in the Bureau of Public Affairs as a subject matter expert in the field of diplomatic history, 19th century American history, public history, and education. She was recently assistant professor of history at Abraham Baldwin Agricultural College in Tifton, Georgia, teaching courses in public history, multicultural America, and early American history. She has also taught diplomatic history and the history of American slavery and abolitionism at the University of New Hampshire and Franklin Pierce University, and worked for Boston African American National Historic Site. Dr. Mann previously served as a Franklin Fellow in 2010 and 11 at the Washington Foreign Press Center in the Bureau of Public Affairs as a Media Affairs Officer for Eastern Europe and Staff Historian. She holds an MA and PhD from the University of New Hampshire and a BA from Rutgers University. She's the author of Horrible Barbarity, the 1837 Murder Trial of Dorcas Allen, a District Slave, Washington, Spring 2015, and also Slavery Exacts an Impossible Price, John Quincy Adams and the Dorcas Allen Case in Washington, D.C., part of her dissertation at the University of New Hampshire. She is currently working on her turning her dissertation into a book manuscript. So let's give her a hand and thanks.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for that warm welcome. You can all hear me okay, right? I despise microphones. Is that all right? Can you hear me? Okay. Before I get started on my presentation, though, I wanted to introduce my colleague, Mr. Ashley Bell, who's also here with me from the U.S. Department of State. We both work within the same bureau. We work for the Bureau of Public Affairs. The Bureau of Public Affairs serves within the State Department to amplify the Secretary of State's message. And Mr. Bell works for the Office of Public Engagement, but he's here for a very special reason, so I'm just gonna turn it over to him, and he's gonna talk to you for a few minutes, and then we'll get on with the presentation.
Thank you so much. This is also a good homecoming for me. I'm excited to be back in Georgia, particularly back in Southwest Georgia. This is a campus that I would frequent when I was at Valdosta State and would come up here every now and then. It was a basketball game. I had cousins that played here under Coach Barksdale. I guess he's gone. I guess he's retired. I hope he should be retired.
He's retired.
Okay, all right. But that was always a great part of growing up in Southwest Georgia. Families from Cordele, and Vienna, and Unadilla in this area. And so, you know, I've had a very fortunate and blessed life to start off in Georgia and find my way to the State Department. It all began with taking advantage of an opportunity. And I want to stress that to everyone today, whether you're a student government, whether you're in any of the clubs here, the moment that you decide that being just in these pews and these desks and learning isn't just enough for you, and you want to join something else to learn more than what you're going to learn in the classroom, that's going to be one of the most important decisions you're going to make while you're in school. And making that decision will sometimes lead you on a track in life that can take you very fascinating places. My first opportunity to do that was asking for an internship in my local congressman's office. It was Sanford Bishop, who's congressman here. I have Kenneth Cutts here, who's the district director for Sanford Bishop's office. And they gave me an opportunity. I became an intern in D.C., and I came back home. I worked for the congressman back here in the second district. And that opportunity is my first time ever really understanding international politics and understanding international issues. When I worked in that congressman's office, I got to learn about trade with Africa and all these sorts of things that sound so foreign to me when I was sitting at Valdosta State. But I can tell you that hopefully today you get to understand that the world's a lot smaller than you think, because we're all challenged with a lot of the same issues. You know, we're a leader in this world, and so many times the great issues of the day, America has to play a very profound role in that. But at the same time, the issues that other countries face, they require a sort of understanding of the world, but they also require some common sense. And that's something that's God-given. Sometimes you got to just break it down to pieces and talk about things like you would talk to anybody else, no matter who they are and where they're from. So hopefully today you get a chance to understand that diplomacy is just that. It's the first line of defense for this country. It's our way of bringing people to the table to reason together, to find ways of coming up with solutions. And sometimes solutions may not be right or wrong. Sometimes, like in a negotiation, everybody walks away a little upset, but they're a little better off because they have some stability. I left Valdosta State and I started off at LSU and I finished law school at the University of Georgia. And I can say that becoming a lawyer probably piqued my interest in trying to throw myself into very complicated disputes on purpose. And that has given me an opportunity to really value what happens in the State Department. And hopefully today when you get to listen to Ms. Mann and what we do and the history of the State Department and where we're going, you can have a little bit better appreciation for that too. But also, don't forget that this is a career option. I sort of stumbled into this, but you don't have to do that. You can be very deliberate, more deliberate than I was. This is a career that's very rewarding. People who come and decide to give their life to service, whether it's government or nonprofits, it's a very rewarding occupation. And you do that by multiple avenues. But I think if you go to the State Department's website, you'll see multiple opportunities for careers. And it's something that here in Southwest Georgia, I know we didn't talk about a lot. So what you have today is an extraordinary opportunity. My entire time in college, I never met anybody from the State Department. My entire time in college, I never did one of these simulations. But here I am working for the State Department today. So you have a leg up from where I started. So take advantage of that. If this is something you're interested in, or serving people, or serving your country is something you're interested in, this is a great way to do it. So hopefully you can listen to this and we can answer some questions later that can help you figure out if this is something you're interested in, or maybe something we can just give you more information. Thank you for your time.
Mr. Bell. So once again, I work for the United States Diplomacy Center, and my office is within the State Department, but unlike any other office inside the State Department, my office is a nonpartisan, apolitical office. And this is really important for you to remember, because normally the State Department amplifies the Secretary's message, who's part of the administration under the President of the United States. But my office is currently constructing a visitor center, a diplomatic center for visitors in Washington, D.C. that's actually attached to the main State Department building. This is a rendering of it. We've just finished what will be Hall 1. This is our pavilion. So cool. It has a glass ceiling, and this is the front entrance. And so visitors will be able to come in and look at exhibits in here. It's attached to what was the original 1940 building that was put up right before World War II started. And it was a merger of the State Department and the War Department. So they actually shared a building. So visitors will be able to come in, they'll be able to see that original, you know, building face right there, and then go on through these other exhibits in the building. And we're hoping to open by early January, maybe like 2019. So we're in the process now of filling up that pavilion there, our Hall 1, with exhibits. We are not funded by taxpayer dollars. If there's anything that you remember today, please bring that back to your friends and your family. We are completely, utterly funded for our exhibits by donations, private donations. That pavilion, the construction of it, for example, was a $40 million endeavor. And we've gotten donations from Microsoft, from large companies, and the smallest donation we ever got was $10 to build that. So this is going to be a museum that's free and open to the public, but it's not maintained by taxpayer dollars. So just want to put that out there, you know, so you know what's going on here with our museum. So I'm just going to kind of give you a little bit of an overview of some of the things that will be inside the museum. This again is sort of the front face of it, so this is where folks will come in. And we are the only museum in the world that is dedicated to telling the story of diplomacy and also having artifacts inside that talk about diplomacy. Has anyone ever been to Washington, D.C.? Oh, a lot of you. So did you go to the Capitol Visitor Center, for instance? Okay, so it'll be an experience very much like, have you been to Washington, D.C.? It'll be an experience very much like that, where you'll go in and you'll see some artifacts. And so it'll be very interesting, I think, for the public to go in there and see that. So this was our groundbreaking ceremony. This was September of 2014. So who do you think are holding those shovels up there?
Who are those people? You're not allowed to
answer.
Not Who are they, if you didn't hear that?
Come on.
Thank you, former Secretaries of State. We were very lucky to have six of the living Secretaries of State there at the Ground Baker. They're all still alive. Nobody's died that I know of. But we couldn't have two of them there because of scheduling conflicts. So can you at least tell me who's missing there? So we've got Hillary Clinton, Madeleine Albright, Henry Kissinger, right? He's still there. He's in his 90s. He's doing great. John Kerry, James Baker, who was Secretary of State under H.W. Bush. And then we have Colin Powell on the end. So, yeah, Condoleezza Rice. She lives out in California. She had a scheduling conflict that day. And then, like, my brain is totally gone. Who else are we missing? We're missing one more.
Schultz.
Thank you. Schultz. Who's also in his 90s, right? But also doing really well. So George Schultz is missing. So this was our groundbreaking ceremony, and that's actually physically where the pavilion is right now. So this was in 2014. And then sitting down here, this is when we opened up the pavilion. We did this in January, so this is very fresh. Man, that was so cool. So we were able to have John Kerry, Hillary Clinton, Secretary Albright, and also Secretary Powell were there that day, and they gave remarks, and Secretary Baker, you know, sent a really nice letter. So it was wicked cool, and we were all so excited we could barely stand it after 2 years of watching that construction. So that was really awesome. That's just a few of our partners. Like I said, we are funded, you know, donations from corporations as well as the general public. And this just gives you a really quick overview of what you're gonna see. That's the pavilion. There'll be a couple of theaters there that people can enjoy. Then they'll go into the lobby there. That's actually going inside the State Department building. And then these will be exhibit halls. And we also have a global classroom where students will be able to connect around the world. This is Hall 1. This is the pavilion with the glass ceiling. Microsoft is funding a map for us that you can see what diplomats do all around the world, where embassies are, what's going on at embassies. We also have this hall here of our bilateral relationships with other countries, so it's really exciting. And then downstairs, we have this open area where we can do events. So, sorry, this is flipping really fast. So what are you gonna see when you go inside the museum? You'll see basically what diplomats do in the history of diplomacy. So what do diplomats do? What's the life of a diplomat like? What do they do? They certainly do something.
This is why you're here.
This is why I'm here? To tell you what they do? Could you guess? Well, do you think that living the life of a diplomat is a glamorous life? Really, you don't think that? Oh, I'm so relieved. Because normally what you hear is, well, you just sit around in Paris all day drinking Bordeaux, you know, and I'm just like, huh? No, absolutely not. Living the life of a diplomat is extremely stressful, right? You gotta be on your toes all the time. And you could create an international incident by just showing somebody the bottom of your shoe, right? Like, I mean, you really have to be like on point all the time. It's a very intense job. And so some of the things that we'll be talking about in our museum are these people of diplomacy. And you can see that diplomats come like in all shapes, sizes. We've got a diplomat up there who's working with disabled children. I'm working with them on basketball. We've got a woman who sits at a consular window. As I was just explaining to another student from the last class, if you become a Foreign Service officer, the first 2 years of your life is working consular duty. It is not a glamorous job at all. You sit in that little box all day at that window, and you have people coming to you who want entry to the United States of America, and they try to pull the biggest scams on you that you can ever imagine. You like get like a person who will show you like a Photoshop picture of himself with like President Obama being like, see, I know President Obama, can I come to America, you know? You just be like, oh, no, sorry. But that's what you do all day. And you are there to make sure that the people entering the country should be allowed to enter, you know, legally and all of that. So that's what you do for a couple of years until you move on to your field of specialty. And diplomats can work in science careers, they can even work in agricultural careers. There's so many different things. They have diplomats who are medical doctors, right? So they're doing all kinds of things.
We will also have a historic exhibit where we'll be showing artifacts that we have. This gentleman right here, from the 19th century, that was the suit he wore, because diplomats used to dress, you know, very formally. They had a uniform, you know, that they would go overseas with, until finally, by the early 20th century, they're like, no more uniforms. That's just ridiculous. We are Americans, you know, we kind of dress down a little bit. No more uniforms. We have that in our collection. So I mentioned the consular window, where diplomats will work, sort of handing out those visas and checking passports. That's an example of a late 19th century passport that we have in our collection, so folks will be able to see the kind of the evolution over time of documents that the State Department has dealt with. We also have artifacts that show the work that diplomats have done for peace and stability throughout the world. That exhibit right up there that says 1988, that's an actual piece of shrapnel that was taken from when they destroyed a nuke. So there was an agreement made that was very heavily worked at by diplomats to reduce arms. You guys ever heard of like these strategic talks to reduce arms? You heard that? Sometimes it's called START. That's the acronym for it. So if you ever hear that mentioned, that's what that is, to reduce the number of nuclear weapons. And so that sculpture was made of a piece of an actual nuke, right, that they had disarmed as a part of that. And this guy down here, we have diplomats who actually work out in the minefield. Diplomats will go out there. They will dig for mines. Like, some of them will work to disable mines so that people are protected in the countryside. The mid-1990s Bosnian War, for example, there were mines littered all over the countryside. We still have diplomats in Bosnia who are digging through the earth to disable those mines. And this was in 1995 that this war occurred. So diplomats will go out there and do that. That's why you can see here, that's the protective equipment, right? We have this in our collection as well to tell the story of the hazards that diplomats sometimes face in their jobs. We also work very hard to combat illegal drug trade. I know this is big in the news right now, right? Keeping drugs out of America. What the State Department does with countries that have huge amounts of drugs coming in is to try to stop that flow at the source. This is a machine that was developed to actually dig up a full coca plant. And this was designed by State Department diplomats who work in the field of engineering. And they made several of these, and they sent them down to Nicaragua and Colombia. It digs up the coca plant. So what illegal drug comes from the coca plant? Cocaine. Yeah, you know that. You didn't know my other question, but you know that. It digs up the full plant, right? And so then it can't be harvested for cocaine. So this is what diplomats do. They're like the preemptive strike, right? You see a problem, you don't just drop a bomb on it. You go in and you try to find creative solutions so as not to disrupt that country like as best that you can. So diplomats are very creative in their solutions and the work that they do. They also do fun things like travel. This shows you an example of diplomatic couriers. So what do you think diplomatic couriers do? Just that word, courier. I don't know if that helped you, my little dance there.
Couriers?
Yeah, you carry something, right. Sometimes when you have to deliver like physical things to other countries, you have to do it like in top secret, right? So there are diplomats that work as couriers, and they have special bags that zip up, right, with all these keys and everything. You guard it with your life. And so this gentleman here in this picture worked as a courier for about 30 years, and he traveled around quite extensively. That's his bag in the center. Those are airline tags from the 1970s and 80s from the bag that he brought all over the world. So we have that in our collection to show people. And the picture on the right is a modern courier. So you can see her bag's a little bit different. It's orange, right? And she's bringing that around. So that's where they carry really important documents and things and as they travel from country to country. And sometimes they have to go in those little prop planes because sometimes you have to deliver something out in the middle of nowhere, right? So we have couriers at the State Department. We also work on what we call sports diplomacy. What do you think are the benefits of using sports diplomacy with other countries? Yeah, exactly. It's a very good way of putting it. Because if you have a baseball team, right, from the United States go and play baseball with another country, immediately it's like that team spirit, right? And so sports diplomats will kind of open the door to that. Sports diplomats are usually not professional diplomats, but they're people that work professionally in sports. We have baseball players who do that for us. They're citizen diplomats, right? They'll go and they'll sort of break those bonds. Believe it or not, the United States at one point did not have good relations with China. I don't know if you've ever heard that. It's actually true. And so one of the ways of breaking into getting diplomat relations started with China was through what they then called ping pong diplomacy. The sport of ping pong is really popular in China. In the early 1970s, an American went over to play a ping pong championship with a Chinese man, so went over there. And because of the success of that, it being publicized on TV, the Chinese finally allowed then President Nixon to actually come over. And President Nixon was the first president to visit China after that door had shut, that communist door had shut after World War II. So sometimes it's the sports diplomats that go in, and then the politicians are invited in. So that's kind of cool, right? That's really kind of cool. So we have examples of that. That's the actual ping pong paddle that was played during that game. This is part of our museum. We are really super psyched. We still haven't gotten over it. We have a huge portion of the Berlin Wall. The Berlin Wall was that large concrete barrier that separated East and West Germany, right? It was a symbolism of the tyranny of communism, and it came down in the early 1990s, and pieces of it were broken up. We have a piece that was actually decorated by an artist, and we have signatures on there from several diplomats and dignitaries who were actually part of that bringing down the wall, so we've got that. Now, our center had to be built around that piece. I don't even remember, it's like 500 billion tons is what this thing weighs. The Germans can really make concrete, that's all I can say. So we had to lift this up by a crane. It went flying past the State Department windows, and all the diplomats were on their phone like, oh, a piece of the Berlin Wall just went by. Oh, that's very interesting. And then it was put in the ground, and we built our center around that piece. So that thing's not going anywhere, right? You know, that's how heavy it is. So folks will be able to see a piece of the Berlin Wall, which is amazing. Citizen diplomacy, I talked about that with the sports diplomacy. We work a lot throughout the country with local fire and rescue. When there is a disaster across the world, sometimes there just aren't enough resources. So we'll work with county EMTs and also rescue folks, and we'll send them out to that country. There was a large earthquake in Nepal a few years ago, devastating earthquake in Nepal. And so we were able to partner with the Fairfax County Urban Search and Rescue. Fairfax County is an enormous county in Northern Virginia, to send out rescue teams to help in Nepal. And of course, the dog. Why do you suppose the dog went with these rescue teams? Yeah, right, to sniff out victims, right? And so in our collection, we have some of these dog vests, you know, so these are just sort of pieces that we have to show how the American people can be citizen diplomats. And the hope is that the Nepalese people will remember what the American people did for them in times of crisis. So we offer humanitarian assistance. So we have examples of that in our center. Will. Now, this is one of the coolest things that we own. I still haven't gotten over staring at these things. Madeleine Albright, the first woman Secretary of State, she was appointed by President Clinton in 1997. Madeleine Albright is hilarious. She's very tiny. When she spoke at the opening of our pavilion, we had to get her a little stool, so she kind of like hop up on the stool and talk, but I would not mess with this woman in a million years. She may be shorter in stature, but she is really tough. So think about the challenges that she had as the first, you know, woman Secretary of State. You know, she had a lot to prove. Like, she had to go out there and really show herself as being a very strong diplomat. But one of the ways that she did it, because she was really savvy, was through her jewelry. Do you ever wear articles of clothing that express your mood? If you're wearing all black, like, don't even, no. Like, today, just don't, right? Or, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe like a funky sort of like bright color, would that maybe reflect your mood that day? And these are these kind of silent feelers that you actually put out to other people. You know, like if you're wearing all black and you're a little standoffish, it's like, okay, don't mess with that person today. But the bright colors, right, it sort of opens up a conversation, right? So that was Madeleine Albright, but she did it through her jewelry. She was very well known for her enormous brooches, her pins, right? And so her pins then served as pieces of diplomacy. And it all started because of Saddam Hussein. Do you guys know who Saddam Hussein is? You're supposed to go boo after I say Saddam Hussein. Do we remember who he is? You guys are so young, but you remember, right? Dictator? Yes, right? War in Iraq? Overthrowing Saddam Hussein? Before that, in 2003, the United States had diplomatic relations with Iraq. And so Madeleine Albright was going to meet with this guy, right? And so she heard that he was talking smack about her, that he was saying bad things behind her back. He called her an unparalleled serpent, that she was like sneaky, like a viper, you know, like a snake. He called her a snake. So she's like, oh, really, Saddam Hussein? So she showed up at the meeting. Sorry about the picture, but see the far left? Madeleine Albright shows up to meet Saddam Hussein wearing this ginormous snaky pin. Yeah. Hi. Right? She didn't have to say a word. But do you think then he knew that what he said had gotten back to her? Indeed, right? So that kind of set the tone, you know, just wearing that jewelry. So then she began to use her jewelry as ways to express her mood. There's a balloon up there. She wore that when she was feeling particularly hopeful about negotiations, like an uplifting sort of spirit. I'm sorry the quality's so bad, but the one in the middle is actually pieces of broken glass. That was supposed to represent her pride as breaking the glass ceiling for becoming the first female Secretary of State. So that was her pin for that. In the far, you see the owl down there? What mood do you think she was trying to convey with her owl? Yeah, wisdom, kind of thinking about things, right? You're sitting there wearing an owl, it's like, I'm gonna ponder this for a while, right? So the owl was like representing thoughtfulness. And down in the far right corner, there's a little bee. What do you think the bee represented? What's that? Tell
busy.
Me.
Busy as a bee.
Busy as a bee? That's pretty good. I didn't think about that.
A stinger.
A stinger. Yeah. So it's like, okay, I'm wearing a bee. It's got a stinger on it. Don't mess with me. I'll sting you. Right? So that was her way of saying that with the stinging insects. You know, but sometimes she wore big butterflies, right, to reflect her mood. So she is going to donate her entire pin collection to the Diplomacy Center. Well, eventually we'll have all of the pins on display. They're now traveling around the country so that other people can enjoy them. So we feel really fortunate to have that piece of history. We also have official gifts that are given to secretaries. I was so mad at my colleagues. I was like, where's that vodka bottle? Okay, picture the vodka. This, I think, is one of the coolest secretary gifts ever. Because the secretaries of state, they can't keep their bling, like they're just not allowed to keep it. Yeah, they can't keep anything. They have to relinquish it over to the State Department. But Colin Powell, when he was Secretary of State, was given an AK-47 vodka bottle. It was shaped like that. It wasn't an actual gun, but it's like this big. And it was filled with vodka. It's this glass. I don't know what to make of that. And he was like, thank you, I think. So you're giving me vodka in a gun. Yeah, I know. So that's one of the more interesting pieces that we have for secretary's gifts. Some of them are so expensive. That piece up there to the left was awarded to Condoleezza Rice from the King of Abu Dhabi. And it is like a $2 billion gold thing, you know? So some of this stuff is really blingy secretary gifts. And, you know, then we have other things like quilts, you know, that are made in Africa to honor the Secretary of State. They're handmade quilts that are made by the local populace and given, you know, as a gift to the Secretary of State. So we have all kinds of stuff. We got the bling, we got the blankets.
So what country was the bottom?
Russia. I didn't want to say Russia, but I don't want to talk about Russia. Okay, tools of the trade. We've also got things like this, sort of showing the evolution over time. We got some blackberries down there. My favorite is this one on the right. It's a pneumatic tube thing. I don't know what it's really actually called. I was thinking about it if we walked in the room. What is that thing called? You know, the whoosh thing that goes through, like when you go to the bank and you put your stuff in? Do they still do that at banks?
Yeah.
They do, right? Yeah, so you put your thing in, it goes, whoop, it's a pneumatic tube thing, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I honestly cannot remember the thing. Okay, so within the State Department, which is like so gigantic now, I can't even begin to tell you, the main State Department building is huge. And so sometimes you couldn't hoof down fast enough to bring somebody like something that needed to be signed. So within the State Department building is all of these tubes. So somebody will like write something up, put it in a tube, and poof, send it back up, and then it'll go all the way across the building, and poof, come back out. So they still do that for correspondence that needs to be dealt with really quickly. So we've got that. We've also got an old typewriter from the Cold War era, stamps, and this is a kerosene slide. Early diplomats to China, when they would go out to rural areas, they didn't have projectors, they didn't have electricity. So what they would do is they'd light this slide lantern with kerosene, and then they'd put slides in to show the Chinese people out there, like, this is America, we're awesome, there's a slide at Disney World, right? They put all that in there to show rural folks where there was no electricity, right, to show a projector. So we've got all kinds of really cool things. We also discuss embassy life. I bet you your dorm rooms look nicer than that. Maybe not. Really? I'll take your word for it. Because sometimes where diplomats have to live, it's pretty grungy, right? Depending on where you go. So you gotta put up for a lot. For a Foreign Service officer, you're usually 2 or 3 years. You know, you could be in Cameroon, you could be kind of anywhere. But you do it because you love the job and you want to represent the United States of America. Sometimes it puts you in really awkward situations where you're out there in the middle of Africa and you're meeting with an African tribal leader and he offers you roasted wild boar on a stick. And you eat it, even though you know you're going to get sick because it's undercooked, and you eat it anyway, right? You just do. It's part of the job. It's part of the job. So I guess what I'm trying to, it's not a glamorous life, You got to work for years and years and years and years and years until you get that cushy Madrid job, until you get that cushy, European job, which sometimes could not be so cushy because that's kind of where all the action and all the trouble is sometimes, right? So it's not always easy for diplomats. The challenges can be immense. That picture on the left is an ambassador. He was actually at the UN, and this was in the early 1980s, and some communists broke in and just threw paint all over him, just like doused him in red paint. That was their way of protesting. I guess red, commie red, red paint. And so we have that suit that we'll display in our museum. Not too terribly long ago, the U.S. ambassador to South Korea was attacked with a razor blade on the street. I was telling the last class, diplomats are the ones, they're at the front lines. They don't have guns to protect them. They go in kind of open, creating relationships, and they are very vulnerable. There have been more U.S. ambassadors that have lost their lives in the cause of duty than U.S. generals have lost their lives over the years. And so that's just the name of the game. Down here, this shows you a photograph of evacuations. We used to have a really nice embassy in Damascus, Syria. Not anymore. When it went down there, you had to evacuate people's families. Evacuations are really complex. You got the dogs, you got the cat, you got the kids, and you got to get out of there. You got to get out of there really fast, right? So that happens sometimes. And then here we have the U.S. ambassador to Iraq is wearing a vest, and he's talking to one of the generals there, right? So State Department and the military work really closely together. We work in tandem many times. We work with our friends over at the Pentagon. Also, I mentioned that global education classroom. Because we don't have a physical space yet, we do a lot of outreach. I try to go out as much as I can and talk to folks so I can sort of bring diplomacy to you. Hopefully you will be able to come to Washington, D.C. one day and be able to see our museum. But we do a lot of global outreach. And in our classroom, we have students who will be able to Skype with diplomats and talk to people all over the world, students from other countries as well, so that'll be really cool. And then, of course, and Mr. Bell alluded to this, we have information about how you become a diplomat. If the idea of eating undercooked wild boar on a stick is really something that you just can't turn down, the Foreign Service may be the career for you. You don't have to be a major in international relations. Diplomats have, like I said, science degrees, they're medical doctors, they're nurses. We have diplomats that work on ocean, checking what's going on with the temperature of the ocean and climate change and all kinds of things. So you don't have to be a major in international relations. You don't even have to know a foreign language. If you are accepted to join the Foreign Service, you'll go through a year of intense training at the Foreign Service Institute, where you will learn not only the language of the country that you're going to, but you will also learn the protocol. You will learn not to show the bottom of your shoe to people. You will learn what is the proper way to introduce yourself to somebody from another country in a way that won't offend them. Not everybody likes to shake hands, right? Not everyone likes that. And then other countries will get you in a bear hug and kiss you all over the place, and you're just like horrified by this, right? But that's the way it goes. And you learn all that while you're in the Foreign Service Institute, and then you will be deployed. They actually call it being deployed. You'll be deployed out to the country that they are going to send you to, and it depends on the need of the Foreign Service at the time. You don't just get to pick and choose, like, I want to go to Mexico, you know? No, you go where they send you, right? But what you do do, you can elect to do hazardous duty. You can elect to do hazardous duty for 6 months to a year. Hazardous duty locations are Kabul, Afghanistan, for instance, some places in Pakistan, where you go where it's a bit more dangerous. One of the last diplomats that we lost in the Foreign Service was a young woman about your age. I think she was 24, you know, really young. She was just in the Foreign Service for a short period of time, and she elected to go to Kabul. And she was with a military envoy delivering books for school children, and the convoy was attacked, and she lost her life. This was about 2 years ago. So it really is dangerous to do this. And there could be, you know, some grenades thrown over the compound at that point. So you know what you're getting yourself into. You sign over, you want to serve the United States of America, and you do this willingly. We diplomats put ourselves in the line of danger so that we could help protect you all at home. I mentioned a little bit about protocol, just some examples of that, how important that really is. Because, you know, the deals that are made, the most important deals, they're not really made sitting at this big formal table, right? They're made over cocktails, martinis, you know, getting these personal relationships with people. That's where the real deals are made. I think that's kind of about what, I'm happy to take your questions. Please do, if you want to follow us and what we're doing, like us on Facebook. That's also our Twitter account, so you can follow us on Twitter. But, if you have any questions, I gave you a lot of stuff that I can answer for you. Yes, sir.
So the first step, if you wanted to be a diplomat, would be to take the Foreign Service exam.
Yes, sir.
And what percentage of people who take the Foreign Service exam are actually accepted into the Foreign Service?
4%.
4%.
So many take that test many, many times. And it's only about 26% who will pass the test, even going around. So you take a written test. It's only offered once a year, and you'll go to some big city. In your case, it would be in Atlanta. You sit down in front of a computer. Part of it is like multiple choice, and then they give you like 30 minutes to write an essay. And there's no spell check. You've got to honk through it. You know, you got to do it really fast. If you pass that exam, you go on to round two, where you write a series of essays that describe your life experiences and why you think you would be a good diplomat. If you pass that round two, then you go on to the third one, where you're actually invited to Washington, and they put you in a room with other Foreign Service hopefuls, and you actually sort of recreate what life would be like in an embassy. They'll say, you're gonna be the diplomacy officer for the public. You're going to be the medical officer. You're going to be this, you're going to be that. So they put them in these roles, kind of like what we did today. And then you give them a crisis, and there's like this mirror, right, where you're being watched the entire time to see how you react, you know, to going on with that crisis. But the really interesting thing that I found out is that you are evaluated from the second you walk in the door for that exercise. Because some people are like so wicked stressed out, they'll just go in and they'll like sit down. There'll be other people in the room with them, and they'll just kind of like sit down. No. How do you think you should react when you go into that room? And there's people sitting around that you don't know. They're going to be taking that. Exactly. You go in there and you offer your hand. You say, hi, my name's Alison. What's your name? And the whole time you're just even sitting there waiting to go into your formal interview, there's people watching you. And they're looking to see how you're going to react and build those relationships. And if you sit down and start staring at your phone, that's it. That's the end of that. And then if you pass that, you do a medical clearance. And then if the needs of the Foreign Service allow, then you would join the Foreign Service. So the process could take a year to 2 years. So don't quit your day job. right, waiting to join the Foreign Service. Does someone have another question? Do you have one, Sarah?
So you could elect to do hazard service.
Correct.
Once you're accepted. What if you, so if you don't, is it a matter of they will deploy you wherever, or do you have any kind of say in terms of choice?
Well, that depends on whether, if you have small children, you know, you could be asked not to be sent there because you don't want to bring your children there, right? So you usually get an exemption for that. If you have a medical problem, if you have like emphysema or asthma, you don't want to go to Beijing, right? Like you do not want to be breathing the air of Beijing because that will be hazardous to your health. So those are certain conditions that you could ask to be reassigned, you know, to other places depending on your situation. But the good thing about if you do the hazardous duty for like a year, then you get to go to Paris for a couple of years, right? So they do take into consideration that you've done that really scary job and then, okay, now fine, we'll send you to a place, you know, that's a little bit nicer. Well, you can be an intern at the State Department. Actually, my office takes in a lot of interns. The bad news is there's no pay for any intern who works at the State Department. And you'll be there in the summertime, and then you'll be working on, you know, some really cool things. You have to go through security clearance. You get your badge, right? So you're given kind of reign of the State Department building. So internships are a great way to go. You can apply for internships on usajobs.gov. And they'll look at those like once a year, right? So just look at State Department interns and then you apply for it like you would a job. Also, I think just getting involved, you know, even volunteering for your local representative, you know, doing things like that. There's a lot of opportunities in DC, you know, that you can really take advantage of, but then you gotta eat ramen noodles like every day. Like it's, that's just the way it goes and live with like six other people because Washington's wicked expensive, yeah. Yes.
What percentage of countries are there embassies in the world? What percentage of countries in the world are there U.S. embassies?
Oh, wow, that's a really good question. I don't know. And our embassies and consulates change all the time, you know, based upon like how much money we have, unfortunately. Some of them will close down because we have embassies that are more formal than consulates, so consulates are usually the first to go. I think it's 194, but don't hold me to that, you know, because they are constantly changing. And because we don't have that much staff, especially in terms of protection, what the State Department will do is train Foreign Service nationals. They are natives of that particular country. So if you go over to the embassy in Ankara, Turkey, more likely than not, when you do have protection, those are Turkish police who are going to be protecting you because the State Department is stretched so thin, right? We do rely on our partners in foreign nations to help us. Did that help a little bit? Anyone else?
It's 294.
294. There you go. Thank you. Did you look that up or do
you
know
that?
Yes, I did. Yes, I know. I can never remember, but it's a lot. It's a lot. And it's constantly changing, you know? I mean, if you told me when I was a kid that one day I would be able to travel freely to China, I would be like, no way. That's never going to happen in a million years. You guys can get on a plane. You need a visa, but it's no big deal for you to go to Shanghai or to Beijing. Like, you just go, you know? I don't know. Maybe one day we'll be able to go to North Korea. I don't know, you know, it's possible, right? It's possible. Who else? Yes, sir.
How would you describe someone who would be well suited to diplomacy? I mean, what kind of traits, kind of characteristics does someone have to have? Do you have to be outgoing? Don't you have like introverted people that are working as diplomats? No, everybody has to be outgoing.
You know, it's interesting that you say that because there are diplomats who work in the managerial, we call it the track, like the track that they work in. And the managerial folks tend to, you know, be a little bit more reserved, you know, so there is room for that. You don't all have to be a maniac like I am, you know. Like, you know, there is for that. But generally, you do need to be able to look people in the eye, you know, meet them where they are at. But if you want to serve and you want to work at the State Department, you can join the civil service, which is what I am. I'm a civil servant. I'm not a foreign service officer. I only work within the boundaries of the United States. But generally in the foreign service, like, you gotta get out there. You really, really do. And not be afraid. And I'm kind of a chicken too, so I don't know if I'd be well suited for that. I hate to fly. Good. Well, I'm happy to stick around for, you know, a few minutes if you had a question that you wanted to talk to me about more in depth. But thank you for coming.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, I know. My-